Alright, we're live. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to Pixels and Pieces. Today we're going to be discussing graphic design and illustration for tabletop gaming. So joining us is Jason Kingsley. He is a game designer and game artist. He was the designer for Ophir, Lanterns, The Emperor's Gift, the upcoming Professor Treasure's Secret Sky Castle, and he also did the art for the original Lanterns, the Harvest Festival, Dead Men Tell No Tales, World Fair 1893, and the upcoming Wasteland Express Delivery Service. Thank you for joining us, Jason.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
All right, so we're going to start with a little bit of discussion on some topics, and then we, if you have anything that you want to score on our end, you want to add in, or something topical that you might want to interrupt, feel free to do so, but we're going to have Q&A at the end. So I guess we'll start with the very basic question. If I'm interested in working on a board game, working on board game art, how do you get started?
Sure. Well, I know that the answer to that question is a little different for various people that I've talked to in the industry, but I can tell you how I did it. Several years ago, when I was starting my freelance career, I posted my work on BoardGameGeek.com. At the time, I posted on the art and design forums, and kind of just said, here's my work, posted some of my favorite pieces that I'd done in the past, mostly illustrations, and said I was looking for work. And from there, I started working with a couple Kickstarter creators who were doing crowdfunding projects for self-publishing. And I actually started doing board game art because I was interested in board game design. So I started attending board game conventions, got to meet and talk to publishers in person. There's just a big difference between seeing a logo on a box and actually meeting the people who represent that logo. And from there, things just kind of snowballed. You know, if you do a good job and find more people to work with, things just keep moving if you don't decide to stop it. So there's a lot of need in the industry for good artists, good graphic designers, and good illustrators right now. I know that some other possibilities would be to get to know other artists in the board game industry, or reach out to artists for things that you like. You could, you know, introduce yourself, show them your portfolio, and maybe even ask for a reference. If they're too busy, maybe they'd be willing to say, hey, I know this person looking to get involved. You can always find the board game community on social media. I use Twitter a lot. There's a fair number of Facebook groups. You can get active in the community, post your work there. And in general, I think just playing a lot of games, getting familiar with names of games and publishers, and taking inventory of all the different components, everything that has a surface that has artwork on it, you know, getting familiar, obviously, with the board game medium and having hands-on experience, I think goes a long way. You can show that, you know, you're interested, you're invested, you've spent time getting to know who you're talking to and what games they've made. So that all goes a long way.
Wonderful. For the topic of today's discussion, and you mentioned it a couple times in your first answer, both graphic design and illustration, and for people who's not deep into art, that those may seem to overlap a little bit. Can you tell us how does illustration differ from graphic design?
Yeah, so I would say a little before my time, maybe before the age of the computer, maybe designer or artist, or all of those terms kind of melded together, and there was a lot more overlap. Today, I think there's more specialization. So an illustrator could be, for instance, a fine artist, someone who creates an image, whether it's digital or in a traditional medium, you know, doing a painting or a drawing, something like that. An easy example would be a book cover jacket. So if you, you know, the main image that you would see on the front of a book, if you picked it up and held it. And then the graphic designer would be someone who would combine everything to create a cohesive package. So they would take care of all of the text, any color, any images, kind of combine them, kind of like a composer, put it all together in a way that, that makes sense and communicates what's supposed to be communicated. You know, so for our book, going back to that example, we would have the book title, the author name, you know, the spine, the back copy, and then on the interior, it would be the graphic designer's job to do the layout. So that would be every word on in the inside of the book. You can imagine what it might look like if you were just to plop a bunch of text down, margin to margin, edge to edge, you know, pick any font size and how just awful that would look compared to someone who would craft that and make it into something that is an enjoyable experience for somebody to engage with.
Cool. So what is the collaborative process usually like between the artist and a publisher and game designer?
Well, that's, you know, it's different between every artist and every publisher. I think a lot of that's maybe dependent on how they prefer to communicate. But typically I find that that a publisher, if you're working as an artist, as a freelance artist in particular with a publisher, they have a particular vision for a game, for a product as a whole. There's obviously a theme that you can kind of work from. They have, you know, hopefully a list of needs and a budget. And once you get started, once you can get past all of that initial stuff, communication just kind of flows back and forth depending on the publisher's preferred mediums. A lot of people just work over email. I've had some clients who prefer to use some sort of online project manager like Basecamp or Asana or, you know, in any of the myriad number of online sites that you could go to kind of collaborate on a project together. Social media, some people I actually DM, direct message a lot with publishers to get quick answers. Occasionally I'll do a Skype or a Google Hangouts or a phone call. Those are a little less rare, but I do always appreciate that direct communication every once in a while, because it reminds you that both parties are human and both are very invested in this project together, that you're working together toward a goal. And occasionally a game designer will be part of that conversation. Sometimes, not always, it really depends on publisher to publisher what their kind of style for producing games are, but every once in a while you have designer or designers chime in once in a while to give feedback on things. And for the most part, I usually find that to be very helpful because it's obviously, you know, it was theirs first and the publisher's second, and they're all very invested in what the final product will look like. But you do want to make sure there's not too many cooks in the kitchen. Somebody, you know, the publisher ultimately is the person out of the three of you who's going to be making the final decisions, and that's always very helpful, you know, just in case there's a couple ways you could go with something, or in the rare case that there's some sort of disagreement.
So are there any standard aspects of design and layout for game art that a new designer should be aware of?
Yeah, so there are a few maybe unique parts of working on a board game that might be different from other print materials. Though there, if you do work in print design, there's a lot of overlap. I don't myself do a lot of web stuff, but of course sometimes there are things that I have to export for use on the internet. But bleed is kind of a big one in the industry, usually on any cards or on a punch board, which is kind of a big, usually square piece of cardboard that they use a machine to punch a lot of cardboard bits out of. There's margin on the inside, but you need to make sure that there's like a safe space that you want to keep clear of anything important that might be cut off when the cards or the punch gets pressed. And then there's bleed on the outside, which is usually 3 millimeters. It can depend on the thickness of the cardboard or the manufacturer, but usually three millimeters interior and exterior bleed on cards. So for instance, if you have a 63.5 by 88 millimeter kind of standard poker size card, you'd add 3 millimeters on the left, right, top and bottom. So that would end up being, plus 6 millimeters to the overall size of that, digital canvas. You want to make sure that you have that there so that when things are cut, they're cut in the right space, and that if there's a little bit of shift, that it doesn't look strange. Like for instance, if you didn't have it and you just had a white border around the edge of the card, and there was any shift, then now you've got white edges along that card instead of maybe, for instance, the full bleed. So that's really important. Once I had a job where an illustrator who was new to the industry didn't know that was a requirement. It wasn't really communicated from the publisher or art director. And so when I got all the files, there was no bleed on any of the assets. So all of a sudden his contract was expired and the game still had to go forward. And I had to use Photoshop to build out an extra 3 millimeters on all of the artwork. So that's an important one. There's some other stuff that's, again, probably pretty common for any print medium, but rich black, which is pure black, is another one that comes up quite often for any text that you have in a game. Especially, you want it to be 100% K. So if you're doing 4-process colors, CMYK, cyan, magenta, yellow, and black, you want to make sure that there's zero of any of those other colors. You want 100% black. Otherwise, there's a possibility that when those different colored plates stamp the text, that you'll have some weird ghosting or it just won't come out very clear. So you've got to make sure that you are working in a CMYK color profile, and you can pretty much guarantee that if you're working in InDesign rather than, say, Photoshop. You make sure that you do all your layout in InDesign for all of your print assets, then you can easily make sure that all of your text and all of your images have the right color profiles and things like that. So those are, like I said, those are pretty common, maybe things that are really important and even that occasionally get messed up. I think just recently I inherited a project that a lot of the art was done in Photoshop, and rather than redo it and put it all back into InDesign, we just kind of moved forward with Photoshop, and it made the process a lot more difficult later on because of how Photoshop interprets things differently. So some words of wisdom and caution there. Also, I guess.
How do you approach merging a game's illustration and graphic design together into a cohesive look?
That one is maybe a lot more philosophy than and practice, just doing it, rather than maybe practical tips that I could get. But I guess I could say that I would say, going back to graphic design versus illustration, that good illustration is evocative. It a lot of people will kind of maybe prioritize illustration because it can be so eye-catching, and that's not wrong. It's just kind of what people do. But good design is, in a way, invisible. It is complementary to the illustration. It is there and it's present and it it's a part of the illustration when it becomes like a final product. But I guess good design, it shouldn't stick out in a way that you would maybe look at a card or game board and say, oh, that type is really hard to read, or that font really like stands out like a sore thumb, or you know, maybe you have different icons and they don't really match. I mean, there's a certain amount of consistency that's definitely required across the board, but when putting them together, it can be kind of difficult to know what the best approach is until you you actually put something on top of something else and print it off. There's a big trend toward digital painting these days versus you know, doing something like an oil painting. It's quicker, it's faster, it's digital. So for instance, on a recent project, there was kind of this messy sort of illustrative look. And there was this question of whether we make the icons kind of messy to try and match, or if we just keep them clean and we allow there to be some contrast between the background illustration and the icons, because they're just sitting right on top of each other. And I don't think that there's like a clear-cut answer, like, well, the illustration is messy, so you make the icons messy. But in this case, in this specific scenario, we decided that was the best way forward, because some people had already seen the cards with a type of messy icon, but the icon didn't have enough. It didn't have enough body to really be distinctive from the background. So there is a certain amount of contrast that you need to have, and even legibility, readability with type on top of a texture or something. If you're you know, doing type on cards, for instance. So it's an interesting dichotomy of trying to create enough contrast where the important graphic design elements are standing off and being separate from the illustration, but when they're all together, they are a cohesive whole, and you don't necessarily think of them as separate separate pieces. They all just become one thing.
Right. So what kind of software tools and resources are important when doing game art?
Yeah. So obviously for final printed materials, you need a computer, you need some sort of software. If you're doing full production sort of stuff, mass produced things, you will need industrial software like the Adobe suite. Or as an alternative, there's some newer products called Affinity. There's Affinity Designer, which is the equivalent of Adobe Illustrator, and Affinity Photo, which is the equivalent of Adobe Photoshop. And I think they're working on a layout software similar to InDesign. Affinity is much cheaper. It's just, I didn't even get it in the Apple Store. It might be available for Windows too. But I use Adobe. That's what I was trained on. And so I have Adobe CC. But aside from the computer, I put a big emphasis on paper. Because just to have on hand for experimenting, to test sizes and shapes, like what the heck does a 1-inch diameter circle really look like, you know, in front of you on the screen? You're going to have a hard time judging what the difference between a 0.75 diameter and a 1-inch diameter piece in a game might be. And so paper, having stuff you can cut out or punch, have in front of you, card sizes, a card sleeve reference is really good for knowing kind of what standard card sizes there are in the industry. Card sleeves are a plastic, piece of plastic that fit over cards, if you don't know what those are. So I put a big emphasis on paper. Also for design purposes, I like staying away from the computer as long as possible and staying with paper. Other maybe resources, Google Fonts is a great asset. Adobe CC, if you have Adobe CC, offers Typekit, a subscription to a site that has a bunch of Adobe Adobe fonts and fonts from other type foundries, so you can get really professional stuff from both of those sources. Let's see. Other tools or resources, prints, like physical prints of things that you are working on along the way are incredibly useful. A lot of times the publishers that I'm working with will make sure that they print and look at, you know, physical samples of things that I've done. And sent over them, you know, to check colors, to check how dark things print, to check if something exported weird, or if I forgot bleed, or, you know, any of the myriad of things that can go wrong between the computer and the printer. So printed samples are really important. I would say even other people are a very important part of the process. You know, not just from a technical aspect, but if you're working on a game and you are printing a prototype, for instance, you want people to experience that hands-on. You want to see how they are interacting with the graphic design, with the user interface, so to speak. Make sure that, you know, they're seeing things in the right places, that they're reading things, that they don't have problems with how the game is being presented, basically. Make sure there's no obstacles to them enjoying it. And then I would say other artists, you know, use other people as a resource if you wanna say it that way. I found incredible value in talking to other artists in the industry, talking to them about their processes, their tricks and tips to save time or to make things go smoother, talk to them about their experiences, good and bad. You know, I think that's a good thing to do as long as you're being honoring to, you know, whoever you're talking about. You don't want to go talking about people behind their backs or anything. But, you know, it is valuable to share experiences, make sure that, you know, you're helping each other look out for possible pitfalls or even companies, you know, that you may not want to work with. It's rare, but it does, you know, that does happen. So talking to other people, sharing what you've learned, getting some encouragement along the way. Sometimes projects take a long time and it's really good to just talk to someone and be like, this project's taking a long time, and you know, get some encouragement to push through and get it done. And there's lots of value in relationships, so don't discount that.
All right, on that note, of speaking to fellow artists to find out some common pitfalls and that sort of thing, are there any common pitfalls that come with doing game art?
Well, we kind of already talked about a few things, like technical issues, like the black text or the bleed, but I guess maybe some other ones could just be real practical, maybe even more general to art or taking jobs in general. I would say, you know, don't take any job. Make sure that you feel comfortable with the person you're working with, especially if you're starting out. Let's say you're working with a first-time Kickstarter creator. Make sure that they, you know, it can be tricky if you don't have a lot of experience and they don't have a lot of experience to set healthy expectations, to make sure that the amount of communication is healthy and adequate. So make sure you feel comfortable with the people you're working with, that you have some communication up front, that there's good expectations and goals in writing, have a contract, get things in writing, have even get a percentage up front on the job as far as payment goes. I guess if you're self-publishing, I could say that, I guess we could probably talk about that later, self-publishing and art, but I would say if maybe you're making your own game and planning to self-publish. Like I said earlier, I wouldn't even plan on touching a computer too soon. I recommend using, just keeping things on paper as long as possible, iterating and creating as little distance as possible between you and your design. And if you have to, use found art for a little bit. Let's see, I think we talked about like doing a layout and text for print and InDesign. Another one I can think of would be don't crowdsource important art decisions. I see this happen a lot, and some people see like creating art, they're spending a lot of time and money, obviously, on the creation of art assets, and sometimes people feel like it's a natural part or extension to, maybe post a couple different options on social media, for instance, and say, hey, this is what we're working on. What do you think is best? And that seems really good on the surface, but what I found is that it kind of sets up you for a lose-lose situation, in my opinion, because you're going to have, let's say you provide two options, and you say, tell us what you think is best. And let's say you have 30% say, I love A, and 70% say, I love B. No matter what, you're alienating, one of those two groups. Let's say you really like A. Well, you're basically telling 70% of the people that have interacted with you, have spent time to engage with you on your project, that you're going to do something different. And I think there's more harm than good that can come out of that. Maybe there's some situations where that's a good idea. I can think of some games that post the cover art, months in advance, for instance, and have done incredibly well. It sets up a lot of hype. But I think in general, like asking for people's opinion on your art on social media is probably a bad idea. I would definitely, like I said earlier, show things to people, but do it in person. Make sure it's relational. Make sure that you know the people who are giving you feedback, and you trust their feedback, and you know what their background is. Obviously, it's really easy in our day and age to have an opinion on everything and to be a critic on everything, but not everybody has the same amount of artistic background or skill sets, and so I think it's important to kind of keep things to an inner circle as far as it goes showing art. That was long, but I hope that's helpful.
If I'm designing a game, when do I start commissioning artwork?
That's a great question. I think I mentioned that I personally like to keep things to paper, even avoiding the computer and printer for as long as possible. Because I think when you're designing a game, especially if you're self-publishing, you want to keep as little space between you and your design as possible. And every step that you put in between you and iterating on your current prototype, I think, just adds more and more time to the overall process and lessens your chance that you're going to finish it or that you're going to be willing to change something, especially, let's say, if you commissioned artwork too early. Let's say you decided to change the theme. Obviously, then, if you commissioned illustration, you won't be able to use it anymore. Or if you've commissioned graphic design and done a bunch of cards, and suddenly you decide to change all the keywords or create a new system of iconography to replace certain words, every step along the way that you have the potential for changes like that are going to cost more time, more money. And so I think probably waiting longer than you think is right is probably the best advice I can give for first-time creators. Don't rush it. I would say you definitely need to make a decision if you're designing a game, whether you're going to self-publish or whether you're going to be pitching to publishers. And if you're going to be pitching to publishers, you probably should spend zero money on artwork. No illustration. Maybe some consultation on graphic design, depending on depending on how much like iconography and layout you have, it may be worth spending some money getting a professional's opinion for an hour or two and saying, hey, can you look at this and tell me how I can improve this? Because maybe your playtesters are having a hard time interpreting some of the stuff or something like that. So there could be some value in that, I think. But overall, if you're going to be pitching your game to a publisher, they're going to be in charge of commissioning artists, both graphic designers and illustrators. And so I would say for prototypes, stick to stuff like Creative Commons or GameIcons.net or TheNounProject.com for any type of icons that you might need to make. You can find just about anything on those sites. And you don't really need artwork for a prototype. It can be helpful, especially if you're pitching or if you're putting it in front of people. But early on, the game should be able to survive on its own without that. So I guess if you are self-publishing and you're planning on crowdfunding on Kickstarter or something like that, make sure that the game is publicly play-tested, even blind play-tested, that you're definitely on track, that you have a schedule, that you know how much time it will take to do the art. You can definitely talk to artists in advance, get some quotes from a couple different people, you know, look for artists, try and find the style. You know, there's tons of stuff along the process that you have to do. And I guess the gist of it is that it's going to take a lot longer than you probably expect. And but that doesn't mean rush into it, because especially as a first-time creator or even a small, even if you decide to do a couple games and you're a small publisher, you know, one big misstep with allocating funds can really hurt your progress moving forward. So always, I think, talk to other people in the industry, get their advice. There's lots of good sources of information from people that I think you've had on the show before, like Jamie Stegmeyer, or James Maffey, or the people that have offered tons of advice on stuff like that. But yeah, hopefully that helps.
All right. Well, those are all of the basic questions that I have. So I guess we'll open it up to any additional questions if you don't have any they would like to ask.
Whose responsibility or where do you think like UI decisions, like this should be a cube or this should be a meeple or this should be a standee, who do you think should be consulted in the process about decisions like that in a game production?
Yeah, I think if you're in the prototyping stage, you know, that's totally up to you. And I think a lot of that will be decided by your own solo tests and public playtesting. If you're using a little 8mm cube on a board that's like 4 feet, you know, by 3 feet or whatever, like some huge board, and people are having trouble keeping track of like their main piece, then you know you could be like, oh well, obviously this needs a standee, or you know, maybe that standee will even be a miniature one day, but for now, like a standee is easy. You know, that's an easy piece. You could buy a standee, you know, base online for pennies probably, a plastic piece, and you know, cut something out of a couple pieces of cardstock or something. And, you know, I think a lot of those decisions will happen along the way, but ultimately if it gets to a publisher, if you pitch it to a publisher, they're going to be making those product design decisions. And I think most that I've talked to or worked with do like to incorporate the designer into some of those types of decisions, but obviously they're the ones who have the expertise on cost and materials and what the factory is capable of, and what, you know, if there's a huge amount of custom pieces, you know, how long that will take to outsource from the factory. Because sometimes, like a factory who does the printing may not do all of the pieces that come in game. They may be sourcing them from other places. So they're the experts on that. Generally, I would say trust them. Look for publishers who have good products and products that you like and that you like to play, and I think you'll be good. Does that help?
Sort of, yeah.
Cool.
Oh, I have a question.
What?
You went into like game design like through the art route, so like would you say that that's easier to do rather than just like trying to be a game designer up front?
I guess it worked for me, at least for now. I think it's good. It was good for me to have some relationships with publishers. It gave me a reason to go to game conventions, even when I didn't necessarily have a lot of designs to show. And I still don't. Sometimes I'll go to a convention, I don't have anything to show as far as my own game designs, but I can always network, and I can always shake hands with a publisher and say, oh, hey, I recognize you from such and such game, or maybe go out to eat with somebody and, you know, they're with some people you don't know. It's a great opportunity to get to know other people, to make relationships, and maybe it'll make sense to work together. So I think it's a positive in the sense that you get to know more people, more faces in the industry. It's not a huge industry. It's definitely growing. I suppose it's a lot bigger if you decide to travel overseas to Essen or something like that, but I haven't done anything like that. I go to, you know, 4 or 5 conventions, I guess, a year. I think it's hard to get your foot in the door as a new designer, as a designer who's not ever made a game before. The ways that that I did that were to, like I said, attend conventions, but also to attend events at conventions. There are a couple places that will run what they call publisher speed dating events, where basically a bunch of designers get to sit down and give elevator pitches to lots and lots of different publishers, whoever decides to show up, basically. And so you get to see a lot of publishers. You don't really get one-on-one time, but you get to see them, and they get to see your design, and that creates a touch point. And that provided some good options for me. I guess options is the wrong word. It provided some good connection points with people that I otherwise would never have sought out or thought to talk to. So that was really valuable. But I think in general, it's difficult to maybe get that first design out there. And I would say the best way to do that, if you're not going to have an in, like as a game artist, would be to make as many games as possible, and to get, I think, for me, I focused really heavily on one or two designs early on, and I think that it, I wouldn't say it was a mistake, because it was really good for me to develop something from start to finish. It's really good to finish something, but I would say broaden your horizon and spectrums, create a lot of things start to finish, even if they're not good. And get a lot of ideas out, and then decide what you want to develop and put in front of people. Because you only are going to have so many people that are going to be willing to play your games, and you're only going to have so many opportunities to show stuff to publishers before before they might just decide to say no before even talking to you. You know, you only have a couple opportunities, one or two, I would say, per game, to really create an impression and say, I think this will be an advantageous relationship for the both of us.
So, like, I guess with graphic design, is there any, like, people that you, like, look up to and, like, try to, like figure out, like, better, like, because I guess, like, with illustration and art, I can see, like, you study the great masters, but, like, what do you do for graphic design? Like, trying to figure out, like, yeah, good examples and things like that.
Yeah, there are definitely people that I look up to. You know, I follow a lot of my favorite graphic designers on Twitter, so I see the work that they're posting, and I've reached out to a couple of them, like I recommended earlier, to just say, hey, I love your stuff, and I would love to talk to you and see kind of what your process is like, what's your day to day look like, how do you manage your time, do you have any files that you're really proud of that you could share with me, so I could see how you built them, or things like that. I guess that's maybe the best example that I could give.
Yeah.
Like that. Yeah.
Are there games that you like that you feel like have the like just amazing graphic design? Like, I mean, because I think illustration, like, people can see awesome games like that, but I think graphic design is that invisible sort of thing.
Right.
Like a graphic designer, you would be able to tell, but.
That is a great, great question. I don't know that I've ever made a catalog of games that I really love. Let's see. There's none that come immediately to mind. A lot of the things that I find that I like, sometimes, like, for instance, if I'm working on a game and I have to do a card frame, sometimes I'll just scour BoardGameGeek or Google Images and look for unique card frames or look at games that I like and go and check those out. So I use a lot of games as reference. I don't know that I have any specific examples of, like, this game I think does it, the graphic design excellently. I know that there are, because I have pictures in my mind, but I can't name names right now. But there are definitely, like, I definitely use other games as research, in a sense that, you know, if I'm trying to create something and I'm not really sure what direction to go, I try and drive some inspiration from things that I you know, that stop me when I see them and I go, wow, that's really, really good. Of course, I'm looking for it, you know, a particular element or something, but I think the ones that do it really well, yeah, they're just like a cohesive whole. You don't really notice while you're playing them. But I sometimes have a hard time even playing games now because I touch so many different aspects between the art and the design, and even as a consumer, a lot of times I have to just tell myself when I'm playing games, you've got to let go, not look at all that stuff, and just enjoy the experience, because it can be hard to do.
Right.
Yeah.
Makes sense. So how much do you guys have to worry about accessibility, like colorblindness and that kind of stuff? Is that something that you worry about, or is that the publisher that kind of?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Stuff like colorblindness is always kind of built in nowadays. Some point there is a shift toward you always try and address this because you want to make it accessible to as many people as possible. So for instance, if you're doing a set of different icons, I think like Ticket to Ride is a great example. If you've played Ticket to Ride, you've got a lot of different color-coded stuff. You've got the different trains in different colors, and on every card there's a symbol, and on every spot on the board where you can place a train there's a symbol. So there's two basically ways to look at that. If you can't easily distinguish a color from another, you can always look at the symbol and know exactly what you're looking at. A lot of times, you know, same thing if you're doing an icon or something. Let's say that they're all black or all white, you know, monochromatic icons. You know, if they're different shapes, obviously, then it's not a problem. But if you have lots of different colors on icons, if they're different shapes, then at least there's a secondary feature that communicates what it's supposed to be.
Keep going. I enjoy questions. So I guess one thing I'm kind of curious about, like from art design aspect, is I feel like almost related to the accessibility is like, I guess like in the issues of gender, I feel like popping up more and more. Have publishers like have you had to bug publishers or publish bug you if you like on issues like that, or that might be too controversial? I don't know. Like,
Did you say on gender specifically, or?
I mean, like, I know, was it Five Tribes that had like slaves on the cards and they had to like change the art on that? And,
oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. These are important issues. I mean, I was kind of curious.
I have moved more into doing graphic design exclusively for board games. I do some illustration. For instance, on Dead Men Tell No Tales, the illustrator did most of it, but like I did the card backs. So it was my job to do the card backs, and that was much more illustrative than graphic design because we used pictures. So just saying, instead of just using a word and say, this is like accessories or weapons or something, you know, I put a picture of a gun on there, a pistol or something like that. So I have done some illustration. I think the issue of race or you know, diversity in general, or you know, taboo sort of issues, like you mentioned, like the slaves and the Five Tribes. I think that is more between the illustrator and the publisher. And it really depends, I guess, on the process and the amount of communication that they have, whether the publisher is giving the artist more creative freedom or if they're directing them more specifically. Is really, really, you know, case-to-case basis. But I would say that's definitely more between the illustrator and the publisher. I know that a lot of publishers are pushing for more diversity in like the characters in the game, for instance. And I think that's a very good thing because there's so many different types of people in the world, and I think more diversity just has a certain richness to it that would not be there without it. But definitely up to the publisher and up to the illustrator's creative vision, I think.
So how often do you have to pick up somebody else's project? Like, because like you mentioned a couple times, like somebody else would start something and then you were like, kind of correcting it or something. Does that happen often in the industry? Is that kind of...
I can't say what sort of regularity it happens, but I think it's probably fair to say that most publishers do hire freelancers. A few have an in-house graphic designer or illustrator, unless you're like Fantasy Flight Games. You probably don't have in-house people, so you're hiring people who are on a freelance basis, and the simple fact is life happens, and sometimes for some reason or another, an artist can't complete a job all the way, or they commit and then have to back out before they get too far in. They might just say, I totally underestimated the amount of work I have on my plate right now. I can't start this until say X day, and the publisher says, oh, that's really too bad because we need this game out on this day. And so every once in a while, a publisher does have to look for another graphic designer or illustrator, or maybe it's a big enough game that multiple people are hired on. But I've done that a couple times. I don't know how frequent it is though.
I have a question. Like, in terms of like producing your own game or self-publishing, how much would a cost basis be for hiring like artists and stuff? Or, how much would you say a percentage wise of your budget should you spend?
Oh, that is a fantastic question, and I cannot give you any good numbers. I personally, if I'm coding a project, I can't obviously give you any numbers without a lot of very detailed specifics, but I kind of look at games as small, medium, or large. I would say a small game would be, you know, obviously package size could be an indication of those categories. Not always. Sometimes stuff is in a medium-sized box that really could be in a small box, but they wanted it in a larger box because they want it to take up more space on the shelf in a store. You know, that's always an option. But smaller games, you know, I'd say a few $1,000 potentially for illustration, and maybe another few for graphic design. It really depends how much text and layout, but I would say there's always a certain amount of work that has to go into creating the logo and a box. Everything has to have a box. Everything has to have a rule book. So the graphic designer, you know, will have to spend a certain amount of time on the rule book, especially if you aren't good. You'll probably want an editor for the rule book as well. Copy editor. The amount of illustrations really depend on your game. If you're trying to create the next Magic the Gathering, you're gonna be out lots and lots of cash. But if you just have a card with like 8 characters, you know, every illustrator is different, but you know, you could expect anywhere from $100 to $300 per illustration for like a piece of card art, for example. So let's say you have eight character illustrations in like a social deduction game, and you want a medium level of detail. Maybe you could expect $150 or $200 per card if you want something really nice, something pretty good. And so illustration is maybe a little easier to quote. Graphic design, I think, is less definitive, I suppose, in how much time it could take compared to an illustrator who's done tons of character cards, for instance, and knows kind of what range it's generally gonna fit in. But I would say, in general, cheap art will be too expensive for you, and good art is definitely worth it, I think. Like the gap between like what you would pay on getting like cheap quick art versus, you know, solid good art may not be that much in the long run. So finding the right artists and reaching out to different artists and finding, you know, getting estimates is always helpful. I generally find illustrators will provide quotes. Graphic designers may provide estimates, but graphic design is more of a service, I think is maybe more apt to like a graphic designer charging just an hourly rate. So it can definitely vary a lot. But yeah, thinking about taking inventory of your game assets, I think is the most important thing. If you're creating a medium weight Euro, you have a board and a box and rules and, you know, 20 different types of things that you're going to have on a punch board, cards, you know, every aspect is going to add more detail and more time because it's not just the quantity, but it's creating a cohesive package. If all of that is going to take more time and more focus and more energy and more money.
Got it. So, like, how do you think graphic design and illustration has changed, like, because I feel like board games have definitely kind of exploded a bit. Do you think, like, the way that publishers and just people, like, look at the art for games has changed a bit in the past couple of years and stuff like that or something?
I think so. I think the quality of artwork and production value on games has gone up, even in the amount of time that I've been kind of following or in the industry, which is maybe 5 or 6 years now. I can think of some of the classics that I found at the time, like Agricola or Princes of Florence or Castles of Burgundy. I kind of got in through playing Euro-style games, and those are all fine-looking games. They're not bad. Even some would say, you know, like Agricola is great, but like Castles of Burgundy or Puerto Rico would maybe be a good example. When I first played Puerto Rico, if you've seen that game, I thought it was incredibly drab and boring. And now I don't mind at all, because I've seen a lot more games, and I enjoy the experience enough that it doesn't bother me. But I think in the last couple of years, the bar has definitely gone up for the quality, because there's just so much coming out that people want to, you know, make an impact, and they want to. And I think also there's just a lot of very passionate people who want to make very good products entering the industry. And I think Kickstarter has also contributed to allowing people to gauge interest up front and essentially get pre-orders, whether you agree with that stance or not, and maybe increase their art budget, you know, do something better than they would have been able to do if they had just self-published without crowdfunding. So, yeah, lots of good things I think are happening.
In terms of self-publishing, would you say that, like, graphic design or the artwork of the game is, like, more important for, like, if you had to, like, choose between, like, spending more money on?
Yeah, if you had to prioritize. As primarily a graphic designer, I would say graphic design is more important. I think the user experience is the primary way that a person is going to touch the game, and I think it's really easy to prioritize the looks and not to prioritize the practical aspects. Now I would say it's really easy to for me to say that, but in practicality, you know, if you're putting something up on crowdfunding, like, and you don't have good illustration, it's just not going to catch anyone's eye. But I would say, I think in general, it's probably easier. I would say it's more difficult to find a good graphic designer, and it's easier to find a good illustrator. I think there's a lot. I think maybe because illustration is more, it lends itself easier to, like, putting online, to having a portfolio, to having a DeviantArt, to, you know, having a website. It's real easy to throw up illustrations and say, this is what I've done. But as a graphic designer, it's a lot harder to be like, look at all these words on the page. Isn't this amazing?
How invisible this is.
It's like, you can even the stuff that I have in my portfolio, like say I have a card, and I've done the frame and the text, it's like it's on top of someone else's illustration, so I have to say, this is my work, but it's also, you know, so-and-so's work. So I think it's a lot easier maybe to find illustrators. And I think it is, I think it's probably, like, with the advent of digital mediums, like digital painting, easier to find somebody who could do a quick sort of style without costing you an arm or a leg. But graphic design, you can't really compromise on. You need what you need, and you need it to be done good. Otherwise, people are going to notice and it's going to be either more difficult for them to engage with the game, or it's going to look really bad. And so I would say prioritize graphic design, find a good graphic designer. But I am not a project creator or someone self-publishing. So take that with a grain of salt.
All right, well, it's about time. Thank you again, Jason, for coming and joining us. So, is there any other words you'd like to leave us with?
Sorry, what was that?
Is there any other words you'd like to leave us with?
Any other words you'd like to leave us with? I would say, it sounds like the class, the course that you are participating in is awesome. I would encourage you to engage with it as much as possible, to continue reaching out to other people. A lot of what I've learned has, you know, been by just doing it, but it's definitely been because other people have been willing to share their experiences, lend a hand, tell me what they know about the industry, being friendly. So yeah, get to know people, continue to work hard, and make something really cool.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.